Hi.
Thriller Recapped here.
Today, I am going to explain an episode called White Christmas from the British science fiction series Black Mirror. Spoilers ahead, watch out, and take care. The episode begins in a tiny cabin in the middle of nowhere. Joe Potter wakes up on Christmas Eve to loud music playing outside. His roommate, Matt Trent, is in the Christmas spirit, but Joe is not in the mood for it. Matt and Joe have been living together for 5 years, but have barely talked to each other. Matt asks Joe his reason for being in the cabin, but he is hesitant to talk, so Matt goes first to ease Joe into the conversation. He starts talking about his life prior to living in the cabin. Matt used to be a love guru, someone who helped nervous boys to flirt with women and seduce them. He used an advanced technology fitted into the eyes of the man, called the Z-Eyes, to watch how the date went and listen to their conversations. Matt talks about one particular case of a man named Harry. Harry is a nervous man around girls, and needs Matt's help to seduce one. It is nighttime, and Harry has to get ready to crash a random office party. Matt starts by turning the Z-Link on. Now he can see and hear everything that Harry does. He asks Harry to change from his clothes to something more masculine. Harry obliges and gets ready. When he first gets into the party, Harry looks around and his eyes land on a dark-haired girl hanging out with a blonde girl and a man. Matt advises him to join the group but talk only to the blonde girl. He does a reverse image search to look for the girl's name and personality on a device. The blonde introduces herself as Amy and the other girl as Jennifer. Jennifer then excuses herself and leaves the conversation. Harry goes to the washroom and asks Matt not to watch while he pees. Just then, we get to know that Matt isn't alone, but a whole group of his friends are watching the interaction online. When Harry goes back, Jennifer is sitting alone far from the party. Matt makes him approach her. Jennifer finally seems to be opening up to him. While talking, she reveals that she used to take pills but isn't taking them anymore. The statement unsettles Harry and Matt, but they don't think much of it. Jennifer goes to the bathroom and Harry starts talking to Matt. He genuinely likes the girl and feels like he is cheating her by taking Matt's help. As he chats, Jennifer returns and sees him talking to himself. She immediately asks him to come over to her place and Harry obliges. She claims that the little voice in her head is asking her to invite him. When they reach her home, Jennifer goes to get drinks after telling Harry to go to her room. The guys watching them are excited, anticipating sexual advances from her, but Harry retaliates, saying that he isn't comfortable with Matt watching. Jennifer comes back with the drinks and demands Harry get on the bed. He hesitantly agrees when suddenly she forces him to take a gulp of the drink. Jennifer thinks that Harry too has voices in his head and assumes Harry is insane, like her. Turns out she has poisoned the drink to kill herself and Harry so they don't have to hear the voices anymore. Matt and the others watching are horrified when Harry starts coughing blood. She eventually forces him to drink the juice and kills him. Matt quickly turns his computer off and asks the other guys to destroy any video evidence they have of the interaction. Matt gathers the evidence in a bin and sneaks out of the room to throw them out. However, he is caught by his wife, Claire. She finds out about his involvement with the crime and him being a perverted love guru. The two get into a fight and Claire blocks him. With the new technology of human blocking, the person being blocked will only appear as an anonymous shape to the blocker. The two cannot talk or communicate. Back in the present, Matt reveals that being a love guru was his side hustle. His main job was somewhat unusual. He starts by talking about a woman named Greta. She is sitting on a hospital bed when a nurse comes and asks if she is ready to perform the procedure. When the process starts, Greta falls unconscious under anesthesia. Then we see something being taken out of the woman's head. A nurse keeps an egg-like device on the table. The device has a mind of its own, but we can hear her talking. It turns out, Greta's whole memory has been coded and put into the device. So, now the egg is a second Greta that cannot move, but still has her consciousness and personality. In the following scene, the device is in front of Matt. He explains to the voice that he works for a company called Smart Intelligence. The company has figured out a way to make digital clones of people and store them in an egg-shaped object. The clones are called cookies and are used as personal assistants by real people. The real Greta has made her a cookie to help her through daily life. A control panel in front of the cookie controls everything in the house like the temperature, lighting, and all the electronics. She has to use them to help Greta with basic things. However, the cookie refuses to be a slave to Greta. Matt has expected this, so he sets a 1 minute timer on the device. During this time, the cookie Greta will live 1 year of life in 1 minute. When the minute is over and Matt talks to her again, she is startled. After spending a year in isolation, she begs Matt to give her something to work on. Matt happily says that she will be working as Greta's assistant from now on. We see then the cookie monitoring the real Greta. She turns the light and alarm on in the morning. She makes a shot of espresso for her and makes a voice narrate her schedule. That is her life now. Back in the present, Joe finally feels comfortable and starts opening up about his life. He had a beautiful fiancée named Beth. On a snowy day, the two go out as Beth's father tells them to be back home soon. In the following scene, we see Beth and Joe having dinner with two of their friends. Beth doesn't feel good after dinner, so she goes to sleep early. As Joe cleans after her, he spills the contents of the bin and finds a positive pregnancy kit. Shocked, he confronts Beth about it. She dismisses it and says that she wants an abortion and is too young to have a kid. Joe tries to convince her, saying that he will take care of the kid, but Beth is strictly against it. When he starts to scream at her, she blocks him. Joe's voice changes into a muffled tone, and the two only see a shadow of each other now. He throws a vase at the wall and storms out of the room. The following morning, Beth rushes to her car outside, while a still-blocked Joe follows her. Beth drives away somewhere and never comes back. The block stops Joe from calling or texting her, so he has no means of communication. A week passes, but she doesn't return. Joe learns that she has left the job without any explanation, and no one knows where she is. Moreover, he cannot even look at images of her, as the block option covers every image of the person. A few months later, he is in town when he sees a silhouette nearby and recognizes it as Beth's. It is clear to him that she is still pregnant. Surprised that she has kept his child, he approaches her and asks her to turn the block off, but all Beth hears is a muffled voice and yells for help. Eventually, the police arrest Joe. He is desperate to meet his child, but doesn't know where Beth is. He knows where her father lives and is sure that Beth is going to be there at Christmas. So, next Christmas, he goes to her father's home, which lies in the middle of nowhere. There, he finally sees Beth and their kid. Since the block option blurs offspring as well, he cannot see if the baby is a boy or a girl. Joe is beyond confused as to why Beth kept the baby but doesn't want him in her life. A lot of time goes by. Joe has made it a ritual to visit Beth's father every Christmas Eve and look at them from a distance. He claims it was like watching his kid grow up, even though he couldn't see the kid's face. 4 years later, he realizes that the child is a girl for the first time. One day, Joe is searching through channels on the TV and sees Beth's picture on it. She had died in a train crash, so the block was turned off. Joe can see her face for the first time in years. The next Christmas, he wraps a Christmas globe as a present for his daughter and heads to Beth's grandfather's home. When he gets a glimpse at her, he is sure she is not his daughter. Shocked, he follows her into the house. He realizes Beth had been cheating on him with her coworker. Beth's father is shocked to see him at his house and asks him to go away. In anger and frustration, Joe hits the old man with the snow globe, injuring his head. Joe left the old man unconscious in the kitchen and never came back. He died in this very spot, and the little girl stayed in her room for the day. The following day, she gave her dead grandfather a gift she had made him. Realizing that no one is going to come, she went out to search for help, while it was snowing heavily. Since the house was in the middle of nowhere, she died of cold. As he finishes telling the story, Joe is in tears. He asks God to forgive him. Matt asks him if he confesses his crime, and Joe admits that he does. He seems to be in an interview with Joe at this point. All of a sudden, Matt talks to someone else, claiming that he has done it and asking them to let him out now. The scene changes to Matt at a police station, talking to some officials. In front of him lies an egg-like cloning device. As it turns out, Matt has been talking to Joe's cookie this whole time. Using the technology, he created his own cookie to try to make Joe confess his crime. Matt had made a deal with the police that if he can make Joe confess, he will be let free for not reporting Harry's death and conducting illegal dating services. The police say that he will be on their sex offender list and will be permanently blocked from everyone. When Matt goes out, he sees that everyone around him is just a silhouette. The world is blurred and muffled for him. Moreover, everyone sees him as a red shadow, indicating that he is a sex offender. A police officer sets a timer of 1,000 years per minute on Joe's device and leaves him like that. The cookie Joe now lives 1,000 years in 1 minute in isolation. We see him struggling to keep himself sane. As the camera pans out, he seems to be inside a loop of snow globes. Subscribe for more videos like this, turn on notifications, and leave a like to help the channel out. Thank you for watching.